Thank you, Mr. Regina, for all that you stand for. I want to, we're probably going to stay a little bit longer this morning than we normally do, but I really feel like if you leave before we get through, you're going to really miss something. And I, just before I do what I'm about to do, I want to invite everybody to be in the fellowship hall with us or the Family Life Center across the way here for a meal after this service. I want to do something today that I have been deep down in my heart had a desire to do for many years, and the right venue, the right circumstances, the right people, the right presence, and all of that has not come to fruition until now. And as you already know by the things that have taken place and happened in the last little while, that Brother and Chief Steve Silverheels and his friends Regina and Rudy are with us. I have a friend of ours from over in our neighborhood, Stanley, that's with us today, that's of Native American descent. And I've just been for a long time wanting to have a service to honor you and your people for the contribution that y'all have made, that your ancestors made, and to a great degree unwillingly, but you know, that's all recorded in the annals of history, and I don't even want to go there, but the contribution was made. And I, for one, appreciate it very much, because had that contribution not been made, we would not be here today in this capacity that we're in. What took place with the Native Americans, the indigenous tribes that were here when our ancestors came, fell into a situation that paved the way for us to be here today to a great degree. And so I want you to listen for just a moment as I bleed my heart to you. And I've got an address I'd like to make here that I have pondered and meditated for many hours and tried to write what I felt. I have probably miserably failed at that, but I've done the best I can, and I want you to listen for the next couple of minutes, if you will, to our Native American friends from the church at Penhoot. The statements and the comments that I will be making in the next few moments will be the true feelings straight from my heart that have been simmering there since I was a kid and began to learn about the history of our nation. I believe that the feelings and sentiments that I will express either are, should be, and or would be the sentiments of most clear-thinking Americans if history was unbiased and the unmolested truth was told and taught to all Americans by the federal government in classrooms and in public media. Much of that history in our now generation mindset is being ignored and or even totally rewritten and being brazenly left out and covered up. I could express a long list of debacles, abuses, and wrongs that were part of American history, and many of which we'd rather forget. Many would rather forget. But they're still real and still factual, and to some degree, a national embarrassment by today's standard. Ignoring these events and our eventual accountability for them will not make them go away simply with the stroke of the writer's pen. I want to be quite clear, however, that in spite of some of her problems, I believe that the United States of America is still the greatest nation on earth, and that if we, Americans, will pull together and apply the instructional challenges of 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and I'll forgive their sin, and I'll heal their land. And if we apply those instructional challenges, as well as the fundamental teachings of the Christian Bible, we can right some of our impending wrongs and become once again a nation that God Almighty would be proud to bless again. However, this morning I'd like to address one specific element of our history that fewer and fewer Americans are aware of as each generation passes. This subject is the American Indian, better expressed in the term Native Americans, specifically the inhabitants of the landmass known as North America, or of the North American continent, and more specifically, those living for millenniums before the appearance of white Europeans in the continental United States. Popular belief based on genetics and archaeological evidence has it that the Indians came from the Eurasian continent to the North American continent by way of a then existing land bridge somewhere in the vicinity of the Bering Straits several millenniums before the appearance of European settlers. Along about the end of the 15th century, there began what was to become a mass migration of white Europeans to North America for the purpose of religious freedom and, of course, and maybe even more compelling, economic and trade opportunities. According to most historical records, trade relations were favorable early on with relatively few acts of hostility from either the indigenous tribes or the settlers. However, as time passed, blind ambition and opportunistic greed led to colonization, and the already skeptically suspicious Indians fearing the inevitability of losing their homeland, and that was to become the case. By the early to mid-1800s, the newly formed United States government had begun an abrasive policy of westward expansion called Manifest Destiny, which used brutal colonization and harsh aggressiveness to push the Indians constantly westward in their lust for more land. The story of what took place between the indigenous tribes of the newly formed United States, along with the land-hungry expansionists and the aggressive colonization policies of the then federal government, is a story that I suppose will never be told in full due to its enormity. I'd like to nutshell that story for you, and I'll take just a couple more moments to do that. From around 1511, at the time of the first official colonial attempts in the New World by European settlers, to the last of the Indian Wars around 1890, which ended with the massacre at Wounded Knee, there were thousands of settlers and Indians killed. Atrocities were plentiful on each side. However, in my research of these issues, I've actually learned more than I really wanted to know. Though I'm not proud of the actions of either side, I regretfully found that American politicians dishonored their word and unashamedly broke treaty after treaty, only to write new ones on paper just as worthless as the previous ones. Thus, the coining of the Indian adage, "White man speaks with forked tongue." That was truly the case, apparently. Very much like most American politicians are doing today, seems that some things never change. For the life of me, I cannot understand how people treat each other with such animosity and cruelty. And I invite those today listening to me to take advantage of many yet untainted historical references and documents by way of the internet and other ways that will give detailed accounts of atrocities committed against Native Americans since early colonial days and even existing today, while by way of social depravity, lack of federal acknowledgement of gross and negligent treatment, and quite frankly, the blatant refusal by the Americans, the United States government, to openly publicize an official apology to the Native Americans for past and present atrocities. Incidentally, that has been done in a closed session of one of the legislative branches, and it was done with no fanfare and very little publication anywhere. That's not an apology. Names such as Cochise and Crazy Horse and Geronimo, Chief Joseph, Osceola, Red Cloud, Sitting Bull, these were real people that were chiefs of real tribes of people. Tribes and families of people that had real babies, real women and children. And real atrocities inflicted upon them. They stand out in the list of faithful warrior chiefs who stood by and fought for their people to protect their homeland, families, and their way of life from the encroachment of European settlers. I read recently some valuable wisdom that came from the hearts of some of these remarkable men. I want you to listen to this, if you will. When all the trees have been cut, and when all the animals have been hunted, and when all the waters have been polluted, and all the air has become impossible to breathe, only then will you realize that you cannot eat money. That was a Cree Indian prophecy. Chief Red Cloud of the Sioux Indians said, "Look at me, I'm poor and naked, but I am the chief of a nation. We do not want riches, but we want to train our children right. Riches will do us no good. We could not take them with us to the other world. We do not want riches. We want peace and love." There's another one by an unknown American Indian that said, "There are no political solutions to spiritual problems." That applies today in this place right now in this time. There are no political solutions to spiritual problems. I do wish to my God Almighty that our leaders in Washington, D.C., from the courthouse to the White House, really, could learn that one principle. What's wrong with America today will not be fixed with money and war. It's going to take bended knees and humbled hearts. And finally this morning, I think I'll close with the summation of all I have attempted to say here for the last few minutes with the words of Chief Red Cloud once again, the last of the Sioux warrior chiefs, who spoke these words, speaking of the United States government and politicians, and he said this: "They made us many promises, more than I can remember, but they kept only one. They promised to take our land, and they took it." And so I say to you, Chief Steve Silverheels, and to your friends present with you today, and to all Native Americans who might read or hear of this service at some time, I and we offer to you our humble and heartfelt apology for the sins and atrocities of our forefathers, and I believe all of our people here today are proud to call you blood brother. Not by the mingling of our physical blood, but by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That has shed His blood and died for us. Amen forever and ever. Thank you to your ancestors and to all that would come this way or go that way. I first met Steve Silverheels a few years ago. And I met him really because of the novelty, my interest in the novelty of him being the son of a great celebrity that most of us my age grew up with, watching on old black and white television. I'll never forget the announcer say when the wheat was blowing in the field and they were advertising Merita bread, "Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear when the Lone Ranger rides again." And of course his Indian friend Tonto was Steve's dad. I soon got by the novelty of the celebrity thing, and I've learned to love this man for his true heart and what he stands for. And we appreciate you very, very much. Steve, will you come speak to us what's on your heart? And
well, praise the Lord, it's good to be back home.
Amen.
I call this home. It's a thrill for me because every time I've come, it seems like my brother's out of the country or in another state. I was kind of getting a complex. But I'm glad to be here. We are glad to be here. And the moving of the Holy Spirit is so important in a service. It's so important in your life. There's nothing like the Holy Spirit moving upon you. And sometimes bringing you to your knees.
Amen.
You know, you learn a lot better on your knees.
That's right.
You can hear the great Creator speak a lot more better when you're on your knees. And I thank God for the moving of the Spirit.
Amen.
I've got a message for you, but it's so late, I'm just going to read from Deuteronomy because I believe it's important. I believe this message is important for today in this country we live in. And so I'm going to read from chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6, 1 through 9. 9 verses, that's all. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you that you might do them in the land whither you go to possess it, that thou mightst fear the Lord thy God to keep his statutes and his commandments which I command thee, thou and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Jerusalem, Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that you may increase mightily, as the Lord God of thy fathers has promised thee, in the land that flows with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon their hands, thy hands, and they shall be as faultless between thy eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and on thy gates. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this written word, Father. We thank you, Father, that you passed it down through the generations to this very generation today, Father. And for those that if you should tarry for those generations. But God, we really appreciate what you are telling us in the scriptures, Lord. That this Bible, this holy word, is important to our lives, to our families, and especially to our country. Now, Father, we ask thy blessing upon the word, upon the ears that heard the word this morning, Father. Open up our eyes that we may behold wondrous things out of thy law. And Father, teach us thy ways, and we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Yeshua Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm just going to touch a little bit on what I have read. I want you to know that the Bible is not just a good book. Do you realize that when you pick up a Bible, you're holding the most powerful weapon ever released to humanity? It's not just a good book. Gone with the Wind is a good book. Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart." The Bible is greater than any other book, just as a mountain is greater than a grain of sand, as an ocean is greater than a drop of water, and as the sun, blazing sun, is greater than a candle. It's not a myth, it's a miracle. The Bible is the only book that can change your life. You can read books by the great poets and authors, such as Shelley, Byron, Shakespeare, but they cannot change you. But when you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the book of Acts, Romans, and the book of 1st and 2nd Corinthians, they can and will change your life. The truths of the Holy Bible can take your sin-stained life and make you whiter than snow. It can take your self-pitying life and turn you into a lion for God. There is more power contained in the Bible than there is in alcohol, drugs, or pornography. There is more power to save. There is power to heal. There is power to deliver from demon spirits. There is power to live with unspeakable joy and full of glory. The Holy Bible is living, breathing word of an almighty and eternal God. It is more than just a book. It's the bread of life and the living water. Jesus said that those who sustain themselves on it will never hunger or thirst. My question to you today is, what does the Bible mean to you? Is it just a good book? Is it a story of ancient history? Certainly it has history in it. Is it a book of literature? It certainly has great literary value. Or is it a book that you can leave out on your coffee table where you dust it off occasionally? Or is it a book that you are wearing out from the inside out because you're reading and studying it? Do you even own a Bible? My friend Slim Pickens used to say, "Don't take my word for it. Look it up in the Holy Bible for yourself." He loved the Lord. He loved the written word. And he was a great actor and a great friend. He was an actor that you wouldn't mind going to see in the movies. Today, I wouldn't give you a dime for all of them. Do you believe the Bible is the infallible word of God? It is the basis for your life, your beliefs, your values, your decisions, your choices, your actions. What you believe about the Holy Bible will determine how you live. If you believe the Bible is the living word of God, and that according to 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished into all good works. Then you will want to study the Holy Word and live out in your everyday life the way the Bible says to live. For me, the Bible is more than a book. It is God's plan and holy message from his heart to mine for my life. It is divine word to me. It is the place that I turn for direction on a daily basis. When we get into obedience with the word of God, he watches over his word to perform it, the Bible says. If it is in the Bible and we operate according to the Bible, God watches over his word to perform it. Jeremiah 33:14. "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised unto the house of Israel and to the house of Judah." And in Philippians 1:6 says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." You take God at his word, by faith in his word. He watches over his word to perform it. Numbers 23:19 says that God is not a man that he should lie. He has no ability, no capability to lie. You have a guarantee when God says, "I will, I shall," that's it. Because the Bible says, "Forever settled in heaven." Psalms 119 says, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven." There's nobody on the face of the earth, not the most decent human being or the most honorable person you know, who can top God, who watches over his word to perform it. When he says, "I will," you can do whatever you want about it. But if God said it, it's coming to pass. God does not fall off the throne because the stock market goes down. Malachi doesn't jump out of the Holy Bible because the stock market goes down. And Philippians 4:19 is still in the Bible, and it says that God shall supply all our need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. No matter what goes on, God is still God. As long as we do what he says, as long as we're doing our part with planting our seeds of faith, God promises to do his part with the harvest. Malachi 3:10, he tells us, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, not part of it, but all of it, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. How many times have I received from God? More than I could ever expect or think. But you know what? The psalmist said, my soul wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from him. And that's where my expectation is, in God. Some folks call the Holy Bible the Holy Word. And that is because of what John 1:1-14 says. In the beginning, was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by him, and without him was nothing made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, hallelujah, the glory as of the Holy, only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Christ the Word is the heart and theme of the Holy Bible. From Genesis to Revelation, the message revolves around the person and Word of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. All things reveal him and point to him. From before creation, God was. Into the eternal ages, he is. So remember, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was God. And the Word was God, with God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And Jesus said, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, in Revelation 1:8. Jesus is called the Word of God because he is the full thought and expression of the mind of Almighty God. Amen. We can know and understand the Father through Christ Jesus. He conveys the truth of God to us. God permeates the Holy Word of God with his presence. He springs forth from every page to meet every man, woman, and child in the form of their needs. He knows your life from A to Z. And he's acquainted with all your needs. As I behold the wonder of Christ in God's word, the sheer beauty and harmony of the man fill my eyes with tears. And I cry, oh Lord, that I might be like you. I know this will be your feeling also as you become acquainted with him through his holy word. There are so many things in the natural that we could panic over. But the question I ask myself when I'm facing a difficult situation is, what does God's word say concerning the situation at hand? For example, what does God's word say about healing? Psalms 107:20 says, he sent his word, Jesus, to heal them and deliver them from their destruction. And then in Isaiah 53:5, he says, and with his, Jesus, stripes, we are healed. What does God's word say about our minds? It says in 1 Corinthians 2:16 that we have the mind of God. And in 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Hallelujah for a sound mind. What does God's word say about our finances? It says in Philippians 4:19 that he will supply all our need according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. In Malachi, he says that we're to prove him and bring our tithes and offerings into the storehouse. Prove me now, wherewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Then, what I love about this next verse is, he says that he will rebuke the devourer. Amen. He'll rebuke the devourer, hallelujah. The word devourer means seed eater. Here God is actually saying, I will rebuke the one who's eating your seed that you sow in faith. The one who's destroying your harvest. The bottom line is, my friend, God's word reveals what God says about any given situation we may be facing in our lives. He says in Jeremiah 1:12 that he watches over his word to perform it. The Bible is the only source of truth. It is the only sufficient rule of faith and standard of conduct. The Bible is infallible. There are no mistakes in it, and it is the inspired word of God. And in order to feed your spirit, man, you must study the word of God. Every thought and attitude must be brought into the direct spotlight of his holy word. You must read the holy word, study it, and cleave to it. It is the most tangible and powerful weapon God has ever given us for our spiritual health and well-being. Remember this, my friend. The more times you give to God, the more effective you will be. You will receive multiple blessings, and God's multiple blessings are his favor. I want you to know that the Bible relates to you now and me now. When the Bible was inspired and written thousands of years ago, man had the same nature he does today. And despite the different methods of living, his problems and needs are still the same. Even though we live in an age and generation entirely different outwardly from the times of the Bible was written, as I read God's word, I feel in the deepest part of my being that God is talking to me. I'm aware that God is, always was, and shall ever be. The word comes alive to you when you realize that through it, God is speaking to you personally. He is inviting you to enter into the experience of the people of the Bible and to relate them to your own problems for comfort, peace, strength, guidance, enlightenment, all this and more. One of my friends' fondest memories I have is about this old black preacher I met many years ago. I came around this old barn, and there he sat in an old cane-bottomed chair, leaning up against the side of an old barn. He was reading out of his old tattered Bible, falling apart, that was on his lap. I heard him chuckle and saw him nod his head. Then I saw tears well up in his eyes. I stopped and I said, Mr. Preacher, why do you cry when you read your Bible? He wiped his eyes and said, when I read the Holy Word, sometimes the Lord just touches me and I can't keep the tears back, he said. Someday, son, when you know Christ for yourself, and you start reading his holy word seriously, you'll understand. Well, many years later, that happened to me. It happened to me. I'll be reading the holy word and tears will roll down my cheeks. And I'll remember that old black preacher sitting in that old cane-bottomed chair, leaning up against that old barn as though it was just yesterday. And that dear old man saying, someday you'll read the Bible for yourself and God will touch your heart. And I thank God he still does today. It was Mark Twain who said, most people are bothered by the passages of Scripture they don't understand. But for me, I have always noticed that the passage that bothered me the most or those I do understand. Some of the greatest lessons I've learned is God is a good God and that he was Abel's sacrifice, Noah's rainbow, Abraham's ram, Isaac's well, Jacob's scepter, Moses' rod, Joshua's sun and moon that stood still, Elijah's mantle, Elisha's staff, Gideon's fleece, Samuel's horn of oil, David's slingshot, Isaiah's fig poultice, Hezekiah's sundial, Daniel's visions, Amos's burden, Malachi, son of righteousness, Peter's shadow, Stephen's signs and wonders, Paul's handkerchiefs and aprons, John's pearly white city. He is a father to the orphan, a husband to the widow. To the traveler in the night, he's the bright and morning star. To those who walk in the lonesome valley, he's the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, and the honey in the rock. He is the brightest of God's glory, the express image of his person, the King of glory, the pearl of great price, the rock in a weary land, the cup that runneth over, the rod and staff that comfort, and the government of our lives is upon his shoulders. Now, my brothers and sisters, may the Lord bless thee and keep thee. And may the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen. I say God bless you, and thank you, Pastor, for allowing me to be here today just to share how important this is to your life. The most important weapon in your arsenal is God's holy word. If you don't have a Bible, I know Pastor will help you find one. Get yourself a Bible. Don't take my word for it. Look it up yourself. Take God's word for it. You'll live a better life and a bountiful life, an abundant life in Christ Jesus. Father, I thank you for all these folks here, Father. I pray that you'll touch each and every one of them, Father. Touch their homes and their families. If any be sick, if any be outside the family of God, Father, I know they stand in the gap, and I stand in the gap with them, Father, that those that are lost will come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, as Peter called him, as I called him, as your pastor calls him. Bless each and every one, Father. Give them traveling mercies, and bless the food, Father, that you provided for us in the fellowship of these people and me and you, O Lord. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Amen. I've read 1,000 sermons.